Many reef keepers are under the impression that if they get water quality parameters to match a certain formula, their corals will color up and thrive. This chasing numbers often leads aquarists to constantly make changes and adjustments to the aquarium at the expense of environmental stability. It's possible to be so focused on numbers that you miss the bigger picture, achieving a stable environment. You've seen beautiful reef tanks that have been running trouble-free for years. Ever wonder what the secret is? They're not chasing numbers. They were all maintained by focusing on what we call the four pillars of reef keeping: lighting, water flow, nutrition, and filtration. Your focus should be on keeping these foundational factors stable and unchanging. It's a time-proven path to having great-looking corals and a beautiful reef tank. Let's jump right into the first pillar, lighting. With reef lighting, it's all about providing photosynthetic active radiation, or PAR. PAR is the light wavelengths symbiotic algae in the coral tissue need for photosynthesis. All high-quality reef lights provide light in the PAR spectrum. PAR is measured with a PAR meter. The unit of measurement is micromole photons per square meter per second. In the hobby, we refer to PAR levels as simple numbers like 150. PAR measurements are made by placing a sensor underwater. PAR is relative to distance from the light source. An LED fixture placed over a shallow aquarium will produce a higher PAR rating than the same light over a deeper tank. Most reef light manufacturers provide PAR levels based on the distance from the light. PAR charts show PAR levels at different depths in the aquarium, so you can get an average level directly under the LED fixture. Research shows that the ideal PAR level for corals is 100 to 200. This level has been proven to maximize the photosynthesis rate of zooxanthella, which will also maximize coral growth. Boosting the PAR up to 200 to 400 will bring out a little more coloration, but could also reduce growth rates. It's a trade-off many reefers accept. Going above this PAR range inhibits coral growth and may lead to bleaching. Use the light manufacturer's PAR chart to determine which fixture is sized correctly to your aquarium. If you have your own PAR meter, use it to dial in the proper PAR level by adjusting the light fixture's intensity. Once you've provided the correct PAR, set the photo period and sunrise and sunset dimming curve, if your light has that option. Remember, we're going for stability. Once the lighting is set up, don't make any unnecessary changes. There is growing evidence that animals, plants, and even corals have an internal clock that responds to light cycles. Known as a circadian rhythm, this internal clock functions on a 24-hour cycle and regulates many biochemical functions within the cells. Disruption of the light cycle appears to cause stress to the organism. That's why minimizing changes in your reef's lighting is important to the long-term health of the corals and other aquatic life. Stability doesn't mean you can't make adjustments or switch out a fixture. You just need to be aware that your corals thrive and color up best when they receive the right PAR levels and have a consistent lighting cycle. The importance of PAR and a stable light cycle is a key factor for having vibrant colors that grow and remain healthy in captivity for many years. On to our second pillar, water flow. For so long, water flow was thought of as simply making cool currents in the tank, but there's some real science that backs up why flow is so important for corals, especially when they're kept in an aquarium. In their natural environment, corals are exposed to many kinds of water movement. The flow patterns range from steady mild currents to cyclic wave action. One thing is for sure, the water movement never completely stops on the reef. Waves and tides constantly flush the reef, washing away waste products and bringing in nutrients and suspended plankton. Since corals don't crawl around and have limited tentacle range, they're dependent on water currents to bring them food and nutrients while washing away gases and wastes. With target feeding and flow pumps, many reef aquarists think of water movement primarily as a way to keep their tanks free of detritus and sludge buildup behind live rock. But there's so much more to water flow when it comes to keeping corals. All solid surfaces, including corals, are surrounded by a thin layer of non-moving water. It's called the boundary layer and separates the corals from the surrounding water. In nature, corals are surrounded by a 1 to 2 millimeter thick boundary layer. Wave motion keeps the layer thin, allowing easier transfer of nutrients and wastes. Oxygen, CO2, wastes, and nutrients have to pass through the boundary layer to reach the coral surface or be flushed away as waste products. The lower the flow, the thicker the boundary layer becomes, making it harder for the corals to carry on their natural respiration, nutrient absorption, and waste processing. Corals rely on water currents to bring food and essential elements required for biologically critical processes. These include photosynthesis by zooxanthella, carbonate skeleton building, reproduction, tissue repair, and nutrient and dissolved gas exchange. There are a number of studies that show zooxanthella photosynthesis and skeletal growth are directly affected by water flow. Inadequate water flow in reef aquariums will reduce coral growth and inhibit their metabolism. But there's more. Researchers discovered that corals are covered with microscopic cilia that constantly beat, creating many vortices that spin in the opposite direction of water flow. The miniature countercurrent patterns at the boundary allow for better exchange between the coral surface and the water. In an aquarium experiment performed to measure the effect of water movement on coral health and growth, vigorous water movement at the surface of the corals increased the transfer of nutrients and wastes by 400%. The fact is, corals must have good water movement to remain in peak health. If your corals are not doing well, it may just be that you don't have enough water flow across your aquarium. Take a close look at each of your corals. Are they all getting the water movement they need? If not, try repositioning your flow pumps. If your tank still isn't getting the coverage it needs, the answer may be to add a second flow pump or upgrade to a gyre-style wave maker. Without adequate water movement, your corals aren't going to color up and look their best, no matter how good the water chemistry is. That's why we say chase colors, not numbers. The third pillar is all about nutrition. In the early days of reef keeping, there was a theory that captive corals received all their nutrition from the zooxanthella living inside their tissue. Through photosynthesis, the algae use waste products from the corals to produce the organic compounds for the corals. Advocates of this idea would say, "I only feed my corals light," ignoring the fact that the reef is teeming with plankton, and corals capture and digest these foods. There was also a fear that feeding captive corals would overload the aquarium water with organics, stimulate algae growth, and make nitrate levels rise. Some reef keepers suggested the corals were just automatically responding to the physical contact with food and didn't really need to feed. But all that changed. As we've seen in the previous videos, we've learned a lot more about keeping corals in captivity. We know more about how reef aquariums function and what corals need to thrive. Through a combination of hobbyist trial and error and scientific research, we have a whole new understanding on coral nutrition in the aquarium. Here's what you need to know. In nature, corals capture and digest algae, zooplankton, and suspended particles containing organic matter and bacteria. These foods provide protein, amino acids, carbohydrates, concentrated trace elements, and other substances used by the corals. Aquarist observations and controlled scientific studies all show that captive corals capture and consume living and man-made foods. Studies show that symbiotic algae provide their coral hosts with significant nutrition, but it tends to be low in nitrogen and phosphorus. Nitrogen is needed to form amino acids, proteins, and photosynthetic pigments that give coral their vibrant colors. Dietary phosphorus is also required for growth and metabolism. Corals must feed to counteract this nutrient deficiency and balance their energy intake. The question is, what do I feed my corals? Aquarium feeding trials demonstrated that Acropora and Posillipora fed live Artemia nauplii, or unfiltered natural seawater, had better growth compared to unfed corals kept in filtered aquarium water. You probably don't have access to natural seawater, but you can feed your corals with a variety of foods, both live and prepared. Live cultures of zooplankton, like reef pods, make it easy to introduce nutritious copepods to your tank. Algae Barn's Tisby Pods and Ocean Magic's Phytoplankton Combo Pack come with live microalgae and Tisby copepods, so you can spot feed or raise your own copepod culture. A refugium is a great way to culture live foods within the aquarium. It provides a protected environment that acts as a live food farm, releasing a variety of nutritious planktonic organisms into the tank. You can also feed your corals prepared foods. Liquid foods are a suspension of ingredients formulated to provide the energy building blocks required for coral growth and coloration. These formulations contain carbohydrates, amino acids, vitamins, and other compounds that corals normally get from their natural planktonic diet. Liquid foods can be target fed or dosed into the water. Dry coral foods consist of fine powders made from dried plankton or man-made formulations. The fine, plankton-like particles are fortified with vitamins, amino acids, carbs, and essential fatty acids. Dry foods are often broadcast into the aquarium's water, where the currents create a plankton bloom for the corals to feed on. You can also target feed a slurry of powder. There is some evidence that there's no one perfect coral food, even among live foods. We recommend experimenting with a variety of food types to see what works best in your reef aquarium. Proper feeding is the third of the four pillars of reef keeping. By providing your corals with the nutritional compounds they need, they're able to resist disease, quickly repair damaged tissue, grow and develop colorful pigmentation. Can you see how light, water flow, and feeding all work together to give your corals what they need to thrive and produce the vibrant colors you're looking for? Our fourth and final pillar is filtration. You're probably familiar with the three main filtration categories: mechanical, chemical, and biological. For this video, we're taking a different approach and focusing strictly on removing organics from the water, why it matters, and how to do it correctly. Did you know your filtration system may be making your water quality worse? Imagine taking your protein skimmer's collection cup filled with stinking skimmate and pouring it back into your aquarium. Sounds crazy, right? But that's about what happens when you don't operate and service your filtration system properly. And here's why. Reef aquariums are amazing because they allow us to keep corals and other marine life alive in captivity. Technology has really advanced the hobby and made reef keeping easier. But no matter how beautiful a tank looks, it's got one thing working against it: the accumulation of organics. Unlike a natural reef with billions of gallons of water flushing away organic waste, our reef tanks are closed ecosystems. This means over time, organics accumulate in our aquariums. Multiple studies demonstrate that organic buildup coincides with lower disease resistance, proliferation of disease-causing organisms, reduced light penetration, and an overall decline in health of aquatic life. Fortunately, we can use technology to remove these organics, but technology won't help unless it's used correctly. A protein skimmer works 24/7 to strip dissolved organics out of the water, but an undersized skimmer won't keep up with the organic load. It's important to size the skimmer to your aquarium based on water volume and livestock loading. As your corals grow and you feed more, the organic load increases. Never cut corners when it comes to selecting a protein skimmer. It's important to understand that skimmers remove organics that are surface active and form foam inside the skimmer. Non-foaming organics can be removed with filtration media like activated carbon and specialty resins. More on that later. Despite looking clear, your aquarium's water is teeming with dead algae cells, crustaceans, bits of fish and coral slime, and uneaten foods. The slime creates a snowball effect, causing the particles to clump together. This forms the sludge that builds up behind live rock and filter sumps. Filter socks are a popular and effective way of filtering out this organic debris. The suspended particles are trapped within the sock's fibers, but if the sock is not cleaned and replaced frequently, the organic particles start to decompose and release dissolved organics and nutrients back into the water. This defeats the purpose of capturing the organic debris because they aren't removed from the aquarium. That's the key to effective mechanical filtration. The particles must be removed from the aquarium, not allowed to decompose within the filter. You can avoid this by frequently cleaning filter socks, sponges, and any other mechanical filtration media in your filtration system. Weekly rinsing of the mechanical filtration media will keep it working efficiently and prevent it from becoming a source of pollution. If you're looking for an automated solution, the Aquamax fleece filter is the answer. It captures organic debris with the filter fleece and automatically rolls the dirty fleece up and out of the aquarium. The fleece roller removes the organics before they can recontaminate your water. Activated carbon is an effective filter media for removing dissolved organics. It's a time-proven technology used around the world to purify the water. Synthetic resins also remove dissolved organics, but they don't last forever, especially in an aquarium. The surface of the carbon and resin becomes colonized by a variety of microbes. Eventually, the absorption sites are filled with organics and covered by bacteria colonies. The media now acts more like a mechanical filter, trapping organic debris. These organics eventually decompose, releasing organics and algae-promoting nutrients back into the aquarium water. We recommend changing activated carbon and resins every month to prevent it from clogging with debris. GFO and nitrate removers can trap debris too. Media contactors make it easy to use granular filtration media. The contactor can be removed from the aquarium and taken to the sink for cleaning and media changeouts. Contactors also allow you to see if the media is getting dirty. The takeaway is organics have to be removed from the aquarium, not permitted to decompose inside filter media. If not, particulate and dissolved organics will suppress water quality, which has a direct effect on your coral's health and ability to color up. Clean aquarium water is the fourth pillar of reef keeping. You can have the latest filtration gear, but unless it's used correctly, you won't get the full benefit. Your water quality will suffer and your corals won't grow and develop their full color potential. We hope you enjoyed this video on chasing colors, not numbers. Understanding the factors that have the greatest effect on your tank's health and stability will do more to stimulate healthy, vibrant corals than chasing and stressing over water chemistry parameters. We've seen these principles help thousands of reef aquarists, and we know they will work for you too. That's all we have for today. Feel free to like and share this video if you find it useful. Subscribe to our channel and click the bell to receive notifications when we release new videos. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to share this beautiful hobby with someone you love.